we are starting with agile principles. So I have 12 agile principles. So you can take a 3-3 group, make a group of three people, and think of that out of these
four this time.
So out of these principles, which one are scalable, not scalable, or scalable with some deviation? So let's start with the basics. So here we have a 12 principles, agile four values. Most of you are comfortable with. So they are very top level. But when we talk about detail, let's start from a principle. So quick 2-3 minutes of discussion, and please mark scalable, not scalable, or depends.
So we will have some ranking here. Highest priority is to satisfy the customer through early and continuous delivery of valuable software. Is it a scalable principle?
Yes.
Directly scalable.
Yes.
Okay. So we go it scalable.
Welcoming changing requirement even late in development process. Agile process harness change for customer competitive advantage.
It
depends.
Okay, let me collect the vote first, then we talk. Delivering working software frequently from couple of weeks to couple of months with a preference to a shorter time scale.
Not scalable.
So we got one vote at not scalable.
Yes.
One team is saying here. And
not scalable.
Okay.
So we get two votes in not scalable. Others were unanimous as of now.
Let's see, this is interesting. And okay, business people and developer must work together daily throughout the project.
Depends.
Okay, so we have depends, two people saying depends. And one team saying, not people, team. One team saying it's not scalable. Okay. Build project around motivated individuals. Give them environment and support they need and trust them to get the job done.
Not scalable.
So we got two votes.
Scalable.
Not scalable.
Okay. इससे पहले वाले का I would go for scalable.
Okay, so there will be a one. Let's see, even team size some. But we had a vote here. Good. The most efficient and effective method of conveying information to and within a development team is face to face conversation. Can we scale this?
Depends. Provided
you have a collaborative team.
Scalable. So
depends.
Not scalable.
Scalable.
You are giving too much not here. And one scalable. Okay, so difficult. I would say that many people are talking about depends. Few are talking about that it is scalable, few are talking about it's not scalable. So we have distribution of it. Working software is the primary measurement of progress.
Scalable.
There is no issue here. This line, good. So it's directly scalable. Agile process promotes sustainable development. The sponsor, developer, and user should be able to maintain a constant pace indefinitely.
Scalable.
Depends and scalable. I think if we can do it in a non-scale environment, we can do it in a scale environment also. So it depends everywhere, maybe. So we have some words for scale and some words for depend.
Depend
column
nahi ho
rahi. It's an easy way out.
Okay, the depend column triggers us that we can figure out some ways of making it scalable. So if we think that it cannot be, like whatever we do, we can't do it, then it is not scalable. But if we think that, if we deviate the process by something, for example, like agile promet sale, so if we have some practices in place, if we have some cadence in place, we can scale it. So okay. That is the intention. Continuous attention to technical excellence and good design enhance agility. Good. Simplicity, the art of maximizing the amount of work not done is essential. ये तो समझ में नहीं आता है मतलब दिस प्रिंसिपल है क्या गुड अमाउंट ऑफ पीपल इवन दे डोंट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट दिस प्रिंसिपल इज ऑल अबाउट
ज्ञान यू शुड लर्न टू से
दिस वुड
सो लेट बिफोर वी कलेक्ट द वोट लेट्स हैव अ कॉमन अंडरस्टैंडिंग अबाउट दिस प्रिंसिपल
So this principle talks about that in life, in project, we should try to make things simple. And the definition of simple is do minimum things, still get the maximum value. So try to do small things, small work, philosophy, and get more work done. So
usually,
can we scale?
Usually 20% of the activities suffice 80% of the
project. Pareto rule. So same rule may be applied for the values also. Same rule may get applied for the problems also, defects also. So, yeah.
I think what this means is that when as a team, when you're working, your focus should be on meeting what is the ask of the project. So generally,
true. So one interpretation is that also true. So rather than thinking too much, let's focus on how to make customer happy.
Yeah, what this says is amount maximize amount of work not amount done. Of work not done essential. So you should be able to identify clearly what is the waste that you are unnecessarily putting in the system.
True. So, can we scale this?
Yeah.
Yes.
Philosophy,
yes.
No?
Yes.
If you can do it in a one team, you can do it in a 100 team also. But yeah, that's another problem that it's difficult to do it in a one team, maybe. Okay, the best architecture requirement and design emerges from self-organizing team.
Yeah.
NS. Not
scalable.
There should be a design authority who is taking care of what has been changed in the architecture wise, in the product. So either you have a dedicated architecture team who is working as one of the scrum team, or have a different mechanism of driving this architecture.
Ensuring something. Can't be just left on self-organizing.
There should be
some proactive, focused approach of managing architecture or evolving architecture, which may require some level of upfront design and development.
Right.
Is that what you are trying to say?
Yeah, that's true.
So,
depends.
Big depend, this wala. This one is big depend. Okay, at regular interval, the team reflect on how to become more effective. Inspect and adapt. So, can we do inspect and adapt in a scalable
environment?
Yes. Yes. So, this scalable. Now, what is this scalable is? We have ranked everything into scalable, not scalable, and depends. When somebody tells us that we want to scale agile, what does it mean? Does it mean more people? So one characteristic which we usually see that, okay, if more than 50 people working on a same project, it's a scaled implementation. True?
Yeah.
What other dimension could be?
Hierarchical management.
Hierarchical management. So what do you want to say with that hierarchical management?
Means at the lowest level there are developers, then there are project managers, and then there are program managers, so who are managing different projects. So
but that may be suiting here only, no?
That is about number, and this is about the...
Okay, so scalable will have a hierarchy. It will have a bureaucracy. So like I was attending one of the Jeff Sutherland's webinar on scaling, he was saying that yes, we need to have a minimum viable bureaucracy in scaling. We can't live without minimum viable bureaucracy. So we need some level of bureaucracy in scaling. Okay.
Or so is it like that you have multiple products and then you have a portfolio and then maybe program?
Yeah, now that's a different level of looking at scalability. Usually whenever we talk about scalability, we think of like how many people. We look across. This dimension is, can we scale agile from team to business?
That is what I was just thinking. One way of what I see scaling is the entire chain of people are in the agile mindset, right?
Yes.
From business to development.
So that's a different dimension of scaling. It talks about if somebody is thinking of new product and somebody delivering the software or developing software, they have integration. It's scaled. So portfolio till team.
So portfolio is like collection of product and services. When you think of that, I want to launch a new product. So that thinking and developers, do they have a connect? In our Agile, we keep talking about that planning onion. So you might have seen planning onion in all of your Agile trainings, that we have planning happening at a multiple layer. We have a day level planning, we have iteration level planning, we have a release level planning, then we have a product level planning, then we have a portfolio level planning. And integration of this is also a dimension of scaling. Okay, another something else. So this was third. The fourth could be distributed environment. So many times distributed team also puts a challenge. Now there could be a small distributed team. It's not necessary that each distributed team is scaled one, but usually the distribution and scaling comes together. So when you have more team, they are usually sitting in a separate geography. So that is another aspect of the scaling. Now we have a common definition of our scaling. Now let's look at here. So first one was, without any confusion, welcoming changing requirement when they even late in the development process. So we spoke about depend. So what is the challenge when we work in such a complex environment? Can't we change? Or is it make some rigidity to change when we have such a top-down or a complex environment? In Pimbo, we keep talking about that even if for the color change, you need to have a change request. Because you don't know that color change may impact the marketing guy, the user manual guy, or someone else. So if you go through a change request, we know we do an impact analysis and then only we approve it. For a developer, it may look like simple, I just need to change the color. So we kept talking about a rigorous change control process. That is something was needed in our traditional project management environment. So when we go here, do we need something like that?
Yeah, because if you see the third point where multiple products are associated with portfolio and then associated with program.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe a change coming to a program may impact the strategy of program or maybe the portfolio. So that's where you need to have a process, where the change can be injected into this whole.
Some kind of action tracking should be there.
Yeah.
Because if some change is coming from a business and the entire chain is agile, so if you take it in the current the current ways of working, probably there are multiple parties involved through which the change is communicated. So there has to be some way of managing that change.
Mm-hmm.
We are not saying right now, I'm not saying that go to a rigorous change process, change request mechanism, but still there needs to be some kind of mechanism defined.
To control and evaluate the impact of
it. Evaluate the impact of it. Because now it is at a bigger level.
Mm-hmm. More people are impacted.
More people are impacted. And here, we are not working with a small development team. We are working, so this change is coming from business and the, because we are talking about scale
mm-hmm.
thing. So the change would trickle down from top to bottom.
Top to bottom also.
So
could
some
be.
Way, some tracking
some,
needs
some
to be there.
Some transparency, some more focused approach is needed rather than saying have a controlled stringent approach. But
I
this is the
focused
approach.
Maybe a little more structured approach.
Structured approach is needed. So how do we manage such kind of things in Scrum? Change management, you got many questions related to it. Eh? So how do we manage in Scrum?
The changes come through generally by the product backlog. So either it's the team who is suggesting the change through the product owner, or the product owner is talking to client and
mm-hmm.
suggesting the change and putting in the backlog and prioritize them.
Yeah, so but how it get controlled? How change is managed? So we understand that product owner tells their priority to the team,
mm-hmm.
but how, what is the mechanism of inserting and deleting item from a product backlog? Most of us don't know. And we leave it on product owner. So in practice, product owner must be having some way of managing it. He can't just think of and insert anything, and he can't just think of delete anything. But we give that responsibility in our normal agile environment to a product owner. He is expected to be a very capable, intelligent guy who understands domain, who understands business, and who can evaluate each and every change before he puts into it. So there was a responsibility given in our basic agile framework as well, that there is a product owner who takes care of it. But when we get into such kind of environment, we may need to have a more focused approach. What Scrum tells about it? if we scale Scrum, do we have some practice which can help here?
No, we are saying scale Scrum means increasing.
Just increasing, working with Scrum in this environment.
Scrum of Scrum
is primarily basically focusing on coordination. There was another meeting which is called Meta Scrum. So Meta Scrum is visualizing what should we do in next iteration, what changes we should be bring our in our product. It is kind of a collection of people, representative from many teams, means product owners from many teams. And we thought of that in general Scrum implementation, scale Scrum implementation, we spoke about hierarchy of product owners. So we spoke about that there is a chief product owner who takes care of every final decision. There are small product owner who works with a team. And if they need some changes, they need to make sure that they are aligned with each other. So we need a structured approach, but the structured approach should be, as far as Agile philosophy, more focused on individual interaction. So there should be some ceremony where issues like these can be discussed, issues like these can be planned or thought of, so that team can take the respective views. So we do need some approach here. Good. So we can scale if we put practices like Meta Scrum, Scrum of Scrum. Scrum of Scrum helps us in integrating and coordinating work, and some hierarchy of product owners where ultimate responsibility relies with one person and he has other supporting people to recommend the changes and evaluate the changes. Okay, delivering working software frequently from a couple of weeks to couple of months with a preference to shorter time scale. Many things is not as scalable. So if we start working in this environment, you think that it will take 1 year before the project will come out?
But at least not couple of weeks, yes.
Couple of weeks to couple of months, even the statement itself is very wide. And couple of months could be one quarter. Okay, so now I do appreciate the fact that it is not that easy when you are working with multiple people, multiple teams. There will be a lot of dependencies, a lot of time who have worked in a scale environment, they find that dependency remains their big problem. It is sometimes perceived, sometimes a good escape route. That if something is not working, we could not meet that dependency. Everything is failing because of dependency. We are perfect. We are doing good work. So a lot of time team end up taking that path also. We did everything, but because of dependency, we could not deliver. Yeah, so it is possible, but as we spoke about, we need a more focused approach for managing these dependencies. True?
Yeah.
So how do we do that? Just forget safe for a while. How do we do that in Agile? If you have to just do it yourself.
So like you put some of the engineering practice like CI, CD, so that you know, at least you are evaluating the software frequently.
So there is a continuous integration of multiple teams rather than only
one team.
And there are good engineering practices which makes the flow fast, not even development, but the flow fast. Good point.
Maybe having dedicated integration sprints.
Could be. Rather than putting a sprint, maybe you have a dedicated integration team who takes care of ensuring that everything,
right.
the CI part.
Yeah.
So there is a one team who is ensure of everything is integrated.
Right.
And if something, if one bug comes, and a lot of time it happens, what to do with an integration level bug? So bug which is traveling from multiple teams, like the impact of a one particular bug which is because of multiple actions. And it requires a modification in a multiple components or which relies into another territories. So you may have a hierarchy of team. Now these practices are not as prescribed in SAFe, we are just talking about. But yes, in Scrum we also talk about there could be a hierarchy of people, like you may have architects who takes care of these things. You may have a team which takes care of these things and some engineering practice. The another thing is upfront dependency planning. Now it may look odd in our say we do plan at the last responsible movement, but your last responsible movement will change as your environment changes. So if you are a small team, 9 people, 10 people team, it's not like you can plan it 2 weeks ahead, 3 weeks ahead. But if you are 100 people team, that last responsible movement may become 1 quarter ahead or 2 months ahead. So the release planning is needed. So the practice which was there in Agile need to be followed. We need to do some release planning where everybody can think of that, okay, we are multiple teams, so
So if one product is going through multiple teams, everybody can think of what is my take for a given release goal. And Scrum of Scrum to ensure frequent resolution of dependencies, issues, which is coming in between. And maybe a chief Scrum Master. A Scrum Master who sits somewhere here. The way product owner sits, a Scrum Master who sits here. Who is responsible for resolving impediments which are following across the team. Simple? These were in place actually. These practices were discussed in pockets since we started reading Agile and Scrum. So they were there. So we need some focused approach here as well. Business people and developer must work together throughout the project. Now, as environment may become complex, you may find that interaction among the individuals starts reducing. So we need to bring some more ceremonies. We need to ensure the effectiveness of our demos. Maybe co-location at a frequency. So like in SAFe we talk about that release planning should be done co-located. So release planning which usually happen once in a quarter, but that event should happen in co-location. Then we can have, since we are having hierarchy of people, there could be a group of individuals who are co-located. For example, the product owner may co-located with the business. For a product management, in say if we talk about product management, he is co-located with the business. The business analyst or a product owner may remain co-located with the team. Traditional Agile, we spoke, or a Scrum, we spoke about product owner and a proxy product owner. Because we don't get product owner, that capable person sitting in our development team. So we always had a concept that, okay, there could be a proxy product owner. Real product owner would be, may not be co-located, but he would be a more powerful guy sitting something like this. But the proxies has a role to make sure that they remain in sync with the real product owner. So something like that can be implemented. And SAFe also has something like that. So such kind of problems can be solved by having such hierarchies. Build people project around motivated individuals. So scalable, not scalable. So it is more to do with the human team development. So that's an important point. Many agile methodologists keep talking about that if you don't have a good agile implementation, you will not have a scaled agile implementation. So before you think of scaling it, you should have a base agile in good shape. You should have your continuous integration, you should have a motivated people, you should have a good retrospectives. If that doesn't exist, scaling will become a mess. So this problem, ensure that we have good agile. And good agile remains the base component of scaled agile. You can't scale agile without having good agile. So most effective and efficient way of conveying information, we somehow covered it. Working software, we spoke about it. That it is possible if we do it. Agile process promotes sustainable development. Again, it's a human culture issue. So this one, the best architecture requirement and design emerges from self-organizing team. Now this one is the most tricky one, how to scale it. Because this requires some thought, the way we spoke about the other practices. In Agile, or in our basic Scrum, when we were preparing for PMICP, our clients, and I was creating content, we spoke about that running iterations till the time you don't have a basic infrastructure ready, and before scaling it. So for example, if you want to scale it to 10 people, you should create a base scaled framework ready by running few iterations by a set of individuals, so that they create the basic infrastructure ready, and then these individuals may get distributed into multiple teams, so they can keep the message consistent throughout the development. So since we are not developing small component here, we do need a focused, proactive approach in architecture. But it does not mean that you will not have an emergent design. It does not mean that design will get baseline before you start development. But it does mean that there should be a continuous refactoring effort which has to be done maybe sometime ahead of the teams. So when teams are coming, like many people talk about that we need to have a technical architect who works as like a commando teams. So before the battalion arrives, they need to create the environment. So they do, they play some spikes, they investigate the situation, and then they will give a green sign that, okay, now you guys can jump in. So somebody has investigated that. So they may work as a commando team which remains ahead, which creates a scaled agile framework talks about a term called architectural runway. So this is that runway has to be maintained and created. So when your new set of teams are coming, or your team is catching up with you, there should be a proactive approach to keep the base runway ready. And runway has to be maintained continuously, because your previous runway was good enough to support, say, 10 aircraft. Now your traffic is increasing because your code base is increasing. You need to maintain it. You need to create new runways. So that is a bit tricky part, which requires a clear focus. But fitting agile principles, the self-emergent or emergent design will remain in practice. It's not necessary that this design will be done by a separate team and will be followed by the development team. Development team will have people who would be associating with the technical architects in order to emerge the design, or in order to implement the design. Yeah, please.
In an environment, the technical architect is weak and the developers are more strong.
So developer becomes a technical architect.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's not like the centralized team is the only one who is doing architecture and design. The concepts which they are visualizing, again, commando team, so you may have a better soldier than commando, but commando has a role to play. Yes, sir.
I'm a little confused.
Mm-hmm.
When we talk of now, I'm just deviating from those principles. When we talk of scaling, so we have to now as a group agree to what is the scaling we're talking about in the session, right?
Okay.
So because when we're talking about all these principles, no, so my mind keeps on going from number three
mm-hmm.
to number one
mm-hmm.
to, because frankly speaking, number one, two, I can by default, having a logical mind, can scale a typical scrum to a bigger level, right? But all the things that we're talking, is it something in line with number three?
Yeah. Good point.
I think before moving ahead, we can just set our focus.
Very good point. When we talk about safe, we need to cover all.
Okay.
But you are very right. When we were discussing these principles, our focus was more or less here and sometime here.
Hmm.
And maybe hierarchy of this. So that the portfolio till product integration may be not that clearly evident in agile principles. True, because it is saying that, okay, we have to work with business, we have to change with business, but does not give a direction for
one, two, and four. Now, when I work with project teams where there are large number of people, you just have to sit them and think logically, and with the Scrum principles in mind, you can still scale up. But that is only if we are doing first, second, and fourth. But when it comes to third, I'm not aware how to actually take it from a business standpoint.
True. So when we get into safe, we will see it. But just to answer your question, even the scaling Scrum at an enterprise level, Ken Schubert has written this book, I guess. So they talk about like enterprise level product backlog. So safe also has more or less similar concept, where they talk about that we have an enterprise level product backlog, which enterprise want to do in next 5 years, and then it get distributed to the team. When we talk about safe or our traditional project, before we move to safe, let's talk about traditional project. In traditional project management, we talk about portfolio team. So we had a portfolio team who evaluate and who gives a go ahead for a given project or a program. So we spoke about like planning onion. So planning onion concept was like, though we were not focusing beyond that, but we were saying that there was someone who is doing this. Now what brings in safe more clearly is it talks about that, okay, there was some business case approval, and then there is some team working on it. There should be a close feedback to that business team also, that how we are implementing that particular business case. What are the challenges faced there? Where are we heading? So that the portfolio group just does not remain only at strategy level. They really know where our execution is going. A lot of time, I worked in an environment where we had a dedicated product portfolio group. Initially, we were facing all these problems. Projects were getting executed. Nobody was knowing which one is the right project, which one is the wrong project. There are multiple departments. Every department was taking their own decision, and we were like a centralized R&D team. So which project get approved, we end up starting on it. And once started, we remain started. So then the organization, what they did is they created a portfolio group.
So no project can start it, get started till the time portfolio group approves it. So things got streamlined. But again, that group was only deciding, prioritizing, saying that this product can go ahead. It was not getting feedback back that what is happening, what with the current projects. There could be that a good value product is approved for going ahead and a low value is still running on because it has started. So then we fix that gap that okay, there should be a feedback back. So we also start taking a call that this project has to be stopped or cancelled. So that kind of loop has been created in SAFE. Okay, so let's take the big picture and then we will have a tea break at 11. And after that, we will have a presentation, which is a SAFE Foundation presentation, which is available at internet also. So I thought of that going through that presentation. This presentation will more focus on values, principles, and the framework. Yeah, please.
Have you seen organization go for SAFE?
Yeah, many. So they have a lot of case studies available on their
what
website.
What I'm saying is, I work with HCL, mm-hmm. and we have exposure with a lot of clients. Now, there are only two vendors who have started talking of that they would be adopting SAFE. But we are not seeing much movement happening around industry on adopting SAFE.
Maybe now that is the question which we were having discussion.
Okay.
The problem and disadvantage and
so
advantage
one,
of the
one
SAFE.
More thing.
Yeah.
For people like us who are in Agile, whether it's the right time to invest for our own training in SAFE,
that was the conversation we were having since you raised this issue.
Yeah.
It's better to close that conversation
yeah.
here. Now, if I have to implement Scrum, I can start with my team. I don't have to care about what organization is doing. I can start organizing my work, prioritizing my work. If they are good with incremental attitude, they will love it. But if I have to start SAFE, I can't do it. Because SAFE, I am not a portfolio guy. I am not a person who can create a program level team. So once you will see the SAFE, you will see there are multiple levels of team. I am just sitting in a team level. So as an individual, as a normal project manager, product owner, scrum master, you don't have an authority, capacity to sell SAFE to the organization. So SAFE can be implemented top down. The organization has to buy in, take a buy-in before they start. Now, that becomes sometimes advantage because people, the organizations who are looking for an integrated framework, the SAFE comes as the solution. It also becomes negative sometimes. The people at the top who are not yet thinking of changing, they feel that everything is doing good. Only the engineering process has to be modified. They will not come to SAFE. They think that Agile is more like an engineering practice. So they will remain ahead. Now, people are moving towards SAFE. There are some good implementation of SAFE. InfoPro, they have been using this name for a while. So they are like, InfoPro is an old adapter. So I think part of their organization was in SAFE. In Bangalore, they keep talking about Yahoo, they keep talking about PayPal and many, many companies. As a professional, if people are moving towards Agile coaching role, they should have an exposure of what is there in SAFE and what is not there in SAFE. And what approach which they have recommended is also available in alternative formats. And how that approach can be used. So that level of awareness, in my opinion, is needed to a professional. Especially SAFE is kind of a default standard when you talk about scaling. There are many, many available, but they are not much popular or not marketed well, whatever the reason is. So since it is well marketed, since it is well known, so as a professional in a service country, we should know it.